Welcome to Hawk Weekly.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jonathan.
I'm Crystal.
And this is Haunt Weekly, a weekly podcast for the haunted attraction, haunted entertainment industry. Whether you're an actor, owner, or just plain aficionado, we aim to be a podcast for you. And we should redo that intro during haunt season. Just say we're a podcast for the living dead. Because I'm pretty sure that describes everyone that might take an interest in be listening to this.
Yeah, that is very true. That's definitely the feeling I'm getting right now. And
I have been fucking worthless today. I've been...
Yeah.
Literally, the only thing I was good for was mattress warmer.
Well, unfortunately, I had to go into an office.
No. And honestly, the way my body temps have been, I don't think I was very good at warming the mattress.
Yeah.
I've been getting hot flashes all day today. We'll get into it. We had a fun night last night. We'll talk about that, but we've been also super busy this weekend. And we worked our ass off all weekend,
mm-hmm.
and then treated ourselves by going out to an event that, we'll talk about it, because it stayed one of our haunt visit plans, but for very, very important and good reason. We're totally justified in this one, I think.
Yeah.
Very important reason to
and
us.
It's adjacent. I think it's adjacent.
Yeah, we're going to talk about it some. I have a feeling we're going to talk about it, because there were actually some lessons, I think, that are applicable.
Yeah.
That I do want to talk about. And I may actually want to pull together a more full episode later, not in season, about what haunters can learn from burlesque.
Uh-huh.
Because we know enough burlesque. We'd even bring someone in.
We could.
We know a shit ton of people.
We do. And we know some horror burlesque people and some people that are both haunt actors and perform in burlesque.
Yeah. So I think there's definitely a lesson there, but we'll get to that in a minute. But first things first, do take a moment, if you have not done so, check us out at hauntweekly.com or hauntweekly on Twitter, hauntweekly on Facebook, youtube.com/hauntweekly is the YouTube channel. Do the likes, the subscribes, the shares, all that social media stuff that we have to keep telling people to do. Otherwise, we're not real podcasters, is what I've been told.
Yeah.
So please do all those things. We really do appreciate it. It actually does help us a lot. And I know we forget, we kind of lose sight of Haunt Weekly interactions this time of year. I can't imagine why.
I don't know.
I don't know what the hell is going on.
There might be something going on all month long.
Yeah, that's driving us all completely bananas. So what we're going to do this week is we're going to update you on what we're doing for our haunt.
Mm-hmm.
Got some pretty killer updates there, I think.
Yeah.
Some pretty sweet updates there. I'm going to update you on that. And then we have three haunt visits to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And
like last week, we forgot to come up with a question of the week. So, yeah.
Okay, I got a question of the week we can ask.
All right.
This is an easy one. And I came up with this on the spot. So, what is something completely new to you you've seen this haunt season?
That's a good one.
What is something completely new to you? And that can be either as a haunt visitor, or as a haunt actor or haunt owner, whatever position or role you take in this industry, what have you seen that has been completely new to you?
You make it sound like we don't make those up right before we go on every week.
Well, usually there's like 2 minutes of thought. This time there's like 10 seconds.
Exactly. But that's a very good question. What would be your answer?
Oh, what have I seen new?
Because you asked.
Yeah, no, and then I didn't actually think of my own goddamn. This is why we usually have 2 minutes of thought. So we can come up with a fucking answer.
That's why I put you on the spot.
Yeah, no kidding. I will say one thing I have seen this season that really does make me smile, and we're going to be talking about this in a bit, is I have seen a lot more paid haunted houses that have been bringing some of that home haunt fun and that type of energy.
Yeah.
Not trying to go for the big, big budget scares.
Right.
And trying to offer a more budget-friendly, as far as the haunt build goes at least, scares. And also bring back some of that good feeling of garage haunting, JC haunting, that type of stuff.
And then those mid-tier haunts that we had seen disappearing, it seems like a few new ones are trying to come into that space.
Yeah.
Which I do
at least
agree.
In our region.
Yeah, I agree with that. That's very good. Well, we saw it in Mobile area, too.
Yeah. So, yeah, no, I would say about half the haunts we visited this year can be identified as being in that space.
Yeah.
Either being lower charity slash home haunt tier or being the more middle tier.
Yeah.
I think between those two spaces, at least half the haunts we've been to are shooting for and aiming for that space.
Yep.
And that's something we have not seen. That's not been our experience in years gone by, especially recent years. And I don't know, it tickles me pink.
Yeah.
It makes me feel good. And it gives us a chance to talk about not one, but two haunts that are in those spaces.
Yeah.
And that is kind of the theme. When we talk about the three haunts, we have one high-end haunt.
Yeah.
One middle tier haunt that's brand new, and one literally home haunt that just got turned into a ticketed attraction.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're going to talk about those three, and it's bingo, bango, bongo. And pretty much in that order, we'll be discussing them.
Yeah.
That should be fun. But first thing is first, we do need to talk about our haunt, and Jesus Murphy, have we been busy?
Yes. Yes, we have.
We need to talk about this because I'm going to forget if we don't talk about it, like, immediately.
All right.
We've been, a lot of the work has been setting up future work. One of the surprisingly large ordeals was getting a crap ton of lumber from Home Depot.
Yeah. But that's not how the weekend started.
Mm-mm.
The weekend started with more clean out. It's almost completely done.
Yeah. It is now in haunt, full on haunt mode again.
Yeah.
Which unfortunately means now the house is full of Lego.
Yes. Yes, there's a lot of Lego. If you were watching during the pandemic, we were building the Lego haunted house set and also a pirate ship.
Three pirate ones. We were doing three different pirate ones from the same set.
Yeah.
It was actually a really cool idea.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, if you did not do the intended set, your bag was all out of order and it became kind of frustrating.
Yeah.
But anyways, neither here nor there. So yeah, we got all that out. It's now... We got it so that both doors are open, entrance and exit are open and accessible. Yeah. Everything has been picked up. Path is open and clean. It's in haunt mode, basically.
Yeah.
The only things that are strewn around are things that need to be put up in that space.
Exactly.
A lot more cleanup took place.
We got the bar back in place.
Yeah, and now we're debating moving it again.
Yeah, this is our life.
Well, and the problem is, and I've been thinking about this all weekend, is we're trying to get into heads of us from 3 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And, like, it's hard enough when we do it year to year to year.
Right.
Trying to remember what the fuck we were thinking last year.
Yeah.
But trying to build off 3 year ago us.
Yeah.
Is proving nearly impossible because I don't remember that person.
Yeah, exactly.
I might have had a drink or two since then. I don't remember that person.
Yeah, and there are some things that I'm finding that just don't make sense. Like, I'm not sure why we did this.
And here's the thing. I am sure we had a reason.
Oh, yeah. I'm positive. Like, but I don't want to change it for that very idea.
Yeah, but we both, and we've run into this so many times already.
Mm-hmm.
Where it's just like you said, why did we put this here and not here? Why did we do it this way and not the correct, that way? I don't know. It's been a fine freaking mess.
Yeah.
But yeah, we ended up making the run to Home Depot, got a whole crap ton of lumber for two projects. If you came by with HauntCon, you saw the haunt as it is in its current state, largely.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things you probably noticed is when you go into the second room, which is a bathroom, there was a stall on the right, and that is where the scare actor is hidden.
Right.
But... On the left, we had just a scene setter with a spooky bookcase on it.
Yeah, it was a bookshelf, you know.
Printed thing. I don't remember what it was. But yeah. It was a giant tarp.
I think it's a shower curtain.
Oh, yeah, I think it was a shower curtain. Yeah. You're right. But yeah, something like that. And that was to hide the breakaway wall, which that actor operates on visitors as they go through the other side.
Right. And we knew that was going to be an issue to leave it like that.
Yeah.
Because people would get scared and then crash into that.
And that would be bad.
Yeah.
And so we had long, that was as far as we could get it for HauntCon.
Yeah.
Because, and they got to remember this with HauntCon, we were canceled for the 2019 season due to road construction. So we stopped work in like mid-September or late September.
Yeah.
And the haunt stayed at that 1 month from opening state up until January, pretty much. And we went from, hey, we're going to have a few beers and show a close group of our friends the haunt.
Yeah.
And we just need the haunt ready for that.
Uh-huh.
To, oh yeah, there's like 200 people coming to your fucking haunt and marching through.
Exactly.
Oh my God.
Yes. Yes, that was a take time off of work to finish the haunt.
Yeah. We did everything we could in the time we had, but we only had a couple of days, realistically.
Yeah.
between the time, getting the time off work, that's a busy time for you.
Yeah.
And between everything, we only had a couple of days to do what should have been a month's worth of work.
Yeah.
On the lawn. So we just did what we could, and that was one of the shortcuts we took.
Mm-hmm.
Sacrifices had to be made. I knew it looked janky, and I knew it wasn't safe, but we're not scaring anyone there.
Right.
Well, we've now built the second stall.
Yes. I'm painting it later tonight.
Which is great, because now the pathway is more narrow. Still more than 36 inches wide. Still yep. completely wheelchair accessible. But now it guarantees the visitors will be close to that scare actor when the door flings open.
Yeah. And they have a good bracing wall to hit.
Yeah, if they get scared away from it. I'm hoping that scare will be a good scare for it. It should be, because yeah. the path to go is incredibly clear.
Yeah. Well, and it'll be one of those things, because I'm planning on working at least some of the night, the first night in there.
Yeah.
To see how it works. Because this is a new design. It's a new scare for us. Haven't seen it anywhere else.
And by either. New, we've had it up for over 3 fucking years. But
yeah, but I mean, it's
we've never actually put it to the test.
Right.
We've never actually really tested it out.
Yeah, so I'm going to be watching to see if I hit it, you know, towards the middle of a group, or if I hit it at the end, what's the different reaction and where do people go?
Yeah, and that one, because of the way the sound comes from, the sound is always going to come from behind them.
Uh-huh.
Because it's hitting a wall to the actor's left and everyone's passing toward the right. So it's going to hit behind, the sound will always be behind them.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a matter of when do you want that sound?
Yeah.
And I agree with that completely. I think that's going to be a one to watch. I think it's going to be very effective,
mm-hmm.
especially now that we've narrowed that gap and they won't be, you know, 4 feet away from it.
Yeah. Because
that was one of the things we were worried about, was we knew that room was tight on space.
Mm-hmm.
And we were very unsure if we could get even a second fake stall there.
Yeah. And it is much narrower. However, whenever you're coming through, you can't tell the how deep the other one is.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's overall still, I think it's going to be a very good scare. I think it's going to work well.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking forward to that getting painted, because the only, because this is a good example of us trying to figure out what the fuck 3 years ago us were doing.
Yeah.
Is we had to deconstruct the stall we built.
Uh-huh.
To figure out how to build this one and make them look close to the same.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm not,
and they're not perfect. Exact,
never will,
but
in
close.
Low lighting to the eye of a customer, they should be perfectly fine.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In the eye of a visitor, they should be just fine.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things we're going to have to do, is kind of be careful of how we light that room.
Yeah.
Like, if I think the lighting plan we have, which are the broken LED bulb things we have.
Yeah, we've got that, and we've got a small yellow light in yeah. there.
I think it'll be fine. But yeah, definitely, I don't think the difference will be too noticeable. I'm looking forward to showing that off somewhere.
Yeah.
We also, so that stall's built.
Mm-hmm.
We installed a bunch of shelving in the last room.
Right, because the gore box that we had fell apart over the last 3 years.
Yeah.
We didn't have room to store it inside the haunt.
And it ended up, yeah, just basically decaying.
Yeah.
And honestly, the more I think about that particular distract, the more I think about that potential scare, it takes up a lot of room.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't really give the actor much to do or work with. It's a cool effect.
It is a cool effect, and we built it specifically for a mobility-impaired actor
yeah.
who can't do a lot but
yeah.
wants to participate. So, but
that actor will not be on our team this year,
right.
unfortunately. They are going into surgery, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So I'm wishing, well, it's your brother.
Yeah.
Wishing him well.
Yeah.
But yeah. So I'm hoping all that goes well, and he's able to do more mobility maybe next year.
Yeah.
Could be fun.
Hopefully. Yeah.
It'd be nice.
Yeah, it would be.
But yeah. And honestly, it's something we could rebuild
mm-hmm.
pretty easily.
Yeah. Like, the mirrors on it are fine.
Yeah, we'll keep the mirrors and store those somewhere.
Yeah, but we've got to get rid of the wood in the base.
Yeah. We've got to finish tearing it down.
Yeah.
All right. But yeah, and the conversion of the bed.
Yes. It is. It now looks more tub-like.
Yeah, we're changing a scene that was a bedroom scene into to a hotel bathroom scene.
Yeah. Exactly. So.
And going more with the actual urban legend of waking up in a tub filled with ice.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah. Yeah. So we've bought a bunch of Little Ice.
Which, by the way, that arrived today.
Oh, good. I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, I forgot to tell you when it arrived. But yeah, it arrived today. It's not a huge quantity of ice, but it is a lot of different types of ice.
Okay. Well, we will see how it looks.
And which we want to buy more of if we need to buy more.
Yeah.
So yeah, honestly, that arrived. It's going to look cool. It is easy to find plastic fake ice. Someone gifted us a crap ton of fake ice.
But it's glass.
And that will not fly.
It's glass and it's heavy.
Yeah, it's too dangerous, especially in the space it's going to be in. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's going to be in a potential impact area. We don't need glass shattering.
Or flying. I don't need people. Yeah,
we don't need that. None of these ice cubes are light, and if they hit someone, they're not going to damage them.
Yeah.
In fact, some of them are actually quite soft and squishy.
Oh, interesting.
So yeah, it's going to be, I think that scene's going to be good. I'm really happy with the way it's coming along.
Yeah.
I think we're in a good place, considering we have one full weekend of work before we open.
And we only have one small build to do.
Yeah.
And that is optional.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so we want to build, I want to build a little door panel between the first room and the last room so that actors can get from either side of the haunt. Mainly me, so that I can get from either side of the haunt really fast if there's a problem. Instead of having to go all the way around.
Yeah. And I think that'd be a good idea.
Yeah.
But like you noted, if we need to, push comes to shove, it can be replaced with a curtain, especially on opening night.
Yeah, especially one of the long blackout curtains.
Yeah.
Because it's in a dark area both scenes.
Yeah, and then we can even stylize it like the bar itself. Get like a red crushed velvet looking curtain.
Okay.
That would actually fit the theme of the room.
Yeah.
I think that would work.
Yeah.
But yeah, we got options, and I'm not worried about it. We can find something to work there. But I think the panel is a good idea, and we should do that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man.
All right. So that's our haunt we've talked about for
10 minutes. Yeah, we talked about it for a while. But
a little while.
Yeah, I'm excited about it. We're going to be posting photos of it at facebook.com/hauntweekly. We'll be sharing what we're working on there.
Yeah, we're already getting calls again.
I've gotten 4 calls today.
Yeah.
On Monday.
Yeah.
We're recording this on Monday, and I got 4 calls. Already.
Yeah, because we did almost all of that work yesterday because we spent the rest of our weekend at haunts.
Yes, we did. And let's just start at the beginning, I guess. The first haunt we checked out this weekend was the Mortuary.
Mm-hmm.
The only haunt actually in New Orleans, as I keep getting reminded.
Other than us.
Other than us, yeah. But yeah, all right, Mortuary. What do we say about the Mortuary?
Okay, first off, their timed ticketed system worked beautifully. We got there right at the beginning of our thing, and we were in within 2 minutes. It was awesome.
It took up a little longer than 2 minutes. There were like 3 groups in front of us, and they were all separated by 2 minutes. So it was about 6 minutes or so.
Okay, it didn't feel like it.
It did. It was definitely fast moving. And it was fast moving, which was weird, given the fact that they do have a 2-minute gap between groups.
Yeah.
And that could, I mean, you can afford that luxury when your line is short, like it was on the Thursday we went.
Yeah.
You really can't afford that luxury.
Right.
When your line is long.
Well, I'm sure they adjust it.
I'm sure they do too. They'd be nuts not to.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, Mortuary this year was interesting because they're celebrating the 150th anniversary of the building, not the haunt, building.
Exactly.
And that's cool and interesting. It is a beautiful building and worth celebrating.
Mm-hmm.
But that meant they just kind of, rather than having like one theme or one story, they just kind of brought everything that they had in storage, including stuff from other haunts they'd worked on.
Yeah.
To the Mortuary. And the result was this was a jam-packed haunted attraction.
Yes, it was very full.
Filled to the gills, as one might say.
Mm-hmm.
Tons of props, both static and animated.
Mm-hmm.
Every room, realistically, outside of the chainsaw exit, every room felt full.
Mm-hmm.
Felt like there was stuff in it. Because that was one of the issues with the Mortuary some years. Was especially in years where they tried to do a theme that was completely different from anything they'd done before.
Right.
And they couldn't reuse a lot of the stuff. The haunt would feel kind of empty.
Mm-hmm.
You'd be relying very heavy on your actors to take up space. You'd be relying... And this time around, even if there hadn't been a single actor in it, it would have felt full.
Yeah. Like, I almost thought that maybe they were going to a full animatronic haunt. But I knew that that was not true because we have friends who work there, both in the makeup area and as actors. And it felt full. I'm going to say this is one of my favorite years that I've been to the mortuary. Now, it's still got issues that we've talked about in the past, like it being too dark in a lot of spaces.
We'll come back to that in a minute. I really want to harp on that for a minute.
Yeah.
To me, I'm a little less enthused, I guess.
Yeah.
Part of my problem is there was so much stuff that in some of the rooms, the human actors felt like they were competing with rather than working with the animatronics and the props. And like, there was this one girl I remember who was in a room filled with zombies. And so many animatronics going off that even when she did her little jump out, she was just another piece of movement.
Yeah.
In this very, very movement heavy room. She didn't stand out, and there's nothing she could do to stand out.
Yeah.
That was my first problem, was I think in some of the spaces it might have actually been too full. Especially if too much moving stuff.
Yeah.
But you hit on, I think, the biggest issue that I have with the mortuary, and that is how dark it is. And I know every time we mention this, someone from the mortuary writes us, and they inform us that this is coming back with the working as intended stamp. This is their design philosophy. This is how they work. You know, and apparently multiple actors have requested better light or more light or whatever. Been told no. So it's apparently the vision of the creators of it. And, that's fine. We don't have to agree on things. But here's the part that kills me. Those are some expensive props.
Exactly.
And I can't see them. And much less, I can't see any detail in them.
Yeah.
And the result of that is you got a $1,000 prop that nobody sees for want of a $1 light bulb.
Yeah.
And I just think that that's a bad deal. And like, there was one room that was particularly frustrating for me. It was a room where you kind of travel through in a perfect horseshoe. You know, you go around, and that center island, I could tell there were static props of people size and roughly people shaped products, props in there. And as we made it all the way around, there was a lightning strike. I don't know if it was in the room or in the adjacent room or whatever, but there were a lightning strike. So for like less than a second, the room became very illuminated. And I could see that each and every one of those was a very detailed, very high-end prop. And up to that millisecond, they'd been nothing but silhouettes to me.
Yeah.
And in the chainsaw hallway, I know there was a person with a chainsaw chasing us. I can't tell you anything about this person.
No.
I can't even tell you how tall they were.
Well, and the room that it's always, always, always been dark is whenever you get down to the basement area and you have to go into, you make the transition from the stairs around like a little L area. That I think that's probably their issue area. You know, we were talking about how
every haunt's got the one funky place.
I bet that that's theirs, and that's why they keep it really dark.
Yeah, because they just don't know what else to do with it.
Yeah.
And I know one of the reasons they keep it dark is to keep people moving slower.
Yeah.
Because it is not a big haunt.
And I'm pretty sure that the actor in there this year was wearing a ninja costume.
A black morph suit type thing?
Oh, I'm pretty sure it was a ninja costume. Like, like I could see their eyes, and that was it.
You know,
like around their eyes, not like a morph costume.
But going through the mortuary, I mean, the acting was solid throughout. And giving a shout out to our friend that does the makeup, a lot of the makeup there. The makeup was great throughout. The props were high quality. The building itself is gorgeous and worthy of exploration on its own.
Yeah.
And all those statements are completely true as far as I could see them.
Yeah.
Which, there's your problem, is I could not see a lot of them. I think about half of the rooms were lit in such a way that I could not tell. And another issue that was kind of weird was some of the sequences, and I bet, once again, this comes from, it's a historic building, they have limits on the modifications they can make. So there's going to be some fucky paths, but there were some rooms where there were some great detail things, but you never got near enough to them to actually see it.
Yeah.
The path did just, it was like 10 feet away, and you couldn't see the detail. And it's just like, sometimes it was dark, sometimes it was at a distance.
I would love to see a floor plan of the entire building and, like, make out what I would do with the space. Because I bet you could add, because you're right, you're 10 feet apart from things, which means you've got a lot of extra space you're not using to scare people.
Yeah. But, yeah, and the other issue is we went in with another couple. Mm-hmm. And they were actually older than us.
Yeah.
Which is weird. We got buddied up with the other old people at the fucking aunt. Yeah. But they were moving faster than I would have liked personally. Mm-hmm. So our time of 13 minutes through it probably is on the fast side. But we had the issue of that we ran into the group in front of us. This, despite them having a literal 2-minute head start. And it's 2 minutes because they have a countdown clock.
Yeah.
You know exactly how long that the gap is.
Mm-hmm.
If I can get a suggestion out there,
yeah.
Since you have to have people watching the steps, and you have to have people watching the steps,
yeah.
Maybe also task them with keeping the distance, keeping things spacing going.
Yeah.
Say, hey, hold up here for 30 seconds or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Have it, you know, you're less than a minute from the group in front of you.
Yeah.
You might catch up to them.
Yeah,
pause here for 30 seconds.
Yeah, because all the security guys have earpieces. They take you out of the scenes. Like, you can't stay immersed in the mortuary because of the stairs. You know, and it's a necessary evil. I get it. I'm so glad you don't scare on stairs. I have seen that. I completely agree with not doing that.
Yeah.
For safety reasons. But, yeah, they can all communicate with each other and say, okay, this group is moving a little faster.
Or even just have a stopwatch and a timer. And if one group shows up less than a minute before the previous one left, hold them up for 30 seconds.
Yeah, just say, hey, wait a minute.
Hold on. You know, gotta let the other group get in.
We're still letting people through. Hold on just a second. And people will stop.
Yeah.
Unless they're, you know, really scared teenagers, and then you're not going to be able to.
And then they really
anything.
Need to fucking stop at the stairs.
Yeah.
They really need to fucking stop there because they're going to get themselves killed.
I wonder how they do that. Like, how they stop them. Because you know that's happened every season.
I'm sure it has. That's a great question. Maybe we should ask them.
No.
But yeah, I mean, the mortuary, like I said, I wish I could see more of it every year.
Yeah.
That is the one problem that has been there ever since the very beginning, is that it's so dark that much of the good work and the good money that went into that isn't on display.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's that they're used to the darkness, so they turn it darker. You know what I mean?
Maybe you have light-sensitive eyes or eyes that could see in the dark better than...
We're not the only ones that have mentioned this, though.
Yeah, we're not.
So.
No, it seems to be a willful choice. I don't understand it.
Yeah, I don't understand why you'd want all that money and all that work on full display. It doesn't have to be lit like a showroom.
Yeah, I will say that I got several startles there.
Yeah.
You know, just the stop in your track and go, huh. And I gave out some good timing compliments to people.
The acting overall was very solid. In fact, that's kind of been one of the great things about this weekend in particular has been the acting throughout.
Yeah.
I really don't have too many notes on the acting this week.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the mortuary. And maybe if we get time at the end, I want to talk a little bit haunt prices.
Yeah.
Because that's something else this weekend has raised concerns about for me. But we'll talk about that after we get through everything. So on Friday, that was Thursday.
Yes.
On Friday, we headed over to HOMA, which for those who do not know, which I suspect is nearly everyone, is a town about 90 minutes away from where we live in New Orleans.
Yes.
And in fact, an interesting thing I learned today was you name a haunted attraction in Southeast Louisiana, 13th Gate, Rise, New Orleans Nightmare, all of them are almost exactly 90 minutes from this haunt.
Yeah.
Because it's just 90 minutes north to get the Rise, it's 90 minutes west to get the 13th Gate, and it's 90 minutes east to get to the New Orleans haunts.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like perfectly in the center of all of them. But yeah, we drove out to HOMA to see Decomposed Haunted House.
Mm-hmm.
This one is operated by a longtime friend of ours. John Farrell's his name. He's a great guy.
Yeah, you've probably seen him in the comments for the show.
And he is someone. If there are any documentary filmmakers out there,
yeah,
that want to like do a story about a haunter that opened in spite of all these obstacles and all these setbacks and all the shit he's gone through,
yeah,
you could do a lot worse than telling John's story.
Yeah, exactly.
You really could. It's a hell of a story. And he's had so many ups and downs. He's been wanting to do this haunt for at least a decade that I'm aware of.
Yeah.
And he has been making panels, building things, and putting it in storage for years.
Yeah, just bringing out, you know, he'll build a new section, show it to the trick-or-treaters and have a party at his house on Halloween night, and then put it all in storage.
Yeah.
With the idea that eventually it was going to be a haunted house.
Yeah. And he's been doing this for a long, long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been incredibly busy. Mm-hmm. But, yeah. So he finally gets to open at Decompose. And I'm glad we had a chance to talk to him before he went in. Because apparently all that aforementioned work kind of got fucked.
Yeah.
Because he was setting up over the summer. And apparently they flooded four separate times in August.
Yeah, because this is an outdoor attraction.
Yeah. That's one of the things I found kind of bizarre. It's an outdoor attraction that you could be very easily forgiven for mistaking it for an indoor one.
Yeah, you could.
It has standard walls, rooms, a concrete floor.
Mm-hmm.
Everything looks like a regular indoor haunted attraction until you look up.
Yeah.
And realize that you're exposed to the elements that direction. There is a brief outdoor part.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, it is very much an outdoor, but indoor feeling attraction.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he's had a rough run of luck trying to get this off the ground. It's been difficult for him.
Mm-hmm.
And first things first, I told him this to his face. I'm telling it to you guys now. The important thing is that it's done and he's open.
Yeah.
Everything that follows that is unimportant.
Yeah. And this is a first year professional, fully... You know, this is bigger than anything he's done, too.
Yeah, and then that's just it. It's like he opened. That is a miracle unto itself.
Yeah.
I'm very happy for him. And it's like I told him, I wouldn't have honestly cared if I'd gone in there and there had been nothing but spirit props.
Mm-hmm.
And that dangling ghost goes, ooh-wee.
Yeah.
And
it wasn't that, though.
No, it was not that.
It was not.
But if it had been, I still would have celebrated.
Yeah.
Because, God damn it, he really busted his ass for this and kept getting screwed and screwed and screwed.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
I was just going to say, before we get too deep into this, I had a lot of fun at this haunt.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I had a lot of fun too. And you know, it's so difficult talking about first year haunts. It's like trying to review a video game that's in early access.
Yeah.
You know, this isn't the finished product.
Right.
The miracle was getting open.
Yeah. Because even with all of those rooms that were completely done and they looked good. You could tell which rooms he had built over the years and which were hallways that needed to be connected to rooms really fast.
Or maybe they were better decorated, but the flood took out.
Exactly.
Some of it. Yeah, there were there was obviously jumps in the detailing.
Yeah.
Is what you're getting at. And yeah, that's a first year haunt type of problem.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I can say that, yeah, there's that issue, but then next year could be completely different. And hopefully
exactly.
It will be because he's finally got a place that mm-hmm. he can work on year round.
Yeah.
That's cool. Mm-hmm. I am super happy for him.
Yeah.
So getting into the actual haunt, when he told us that most of the actors were first year,
yeah,
I almost didn't believe him.
Mm-hmm.
This was some very clever timing. There's one kid, and I know he had to be a kid to me because he was tiny, but he was on a bed with a sheet pulled up over him, and I stared at his ass just long enough to convince myself that, okay, I guess this is a static prop.
Yeah.
And starting to walk away, and then he starts thrashing and
throwing. And it was an old metal bed, so it made a great noise.
It's such a simple scare, but it requires patience and timing that is so difficult to get as a new actor.
Yeah, because a lot of people, they're like, oh, somebody's in the room.
Scare him now, get him. No, he let that shit breathe.
Yeah.
For almost a fucking minute, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. And that was good. That was a lot of fun. I think this is the haunt that has gotten the most reactions out of me.
Yeah. And part of it is, you can tell John sort of a design philosophy similar to ours.
Yeah.
Builds rooms for actors to get scares.
Yeah.
He doesn't build a boiler room.
No.
He builds a room with a boo hole, a place that the actor to do a scare. Or multiple holes like that. Mm-hmm. And then paints it like a boiler room.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is exactly how it should be done. So if you're looking for a haunt that is a pretty good class on scare tactics,
mm-hmm.
I would say this is a good one. And that's just it. You talked about how this got a lot of startles and a lot of jumps. Yeah, it did for me too. And I think the reason it did was because of the design.
Yeah.
And that is free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it felt longer than it was when we went through.
Yeah, it was only a 6-minute walkthrough for us.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, it did feel longer, A. And, I mean, so yeah, it's a good haunt for a first year especially.
Mm-hmm.
But the main thing I'm excited about is this is the platform.
Yeah.
What's next?
Yeah, exactly. This is going to be one to look forward to every
year. Yeah, because, I mean, like, I remember the first years at Rise.
Mm-hmm.
They were rough in places, too.
Yeah.
But Rise quickly grew up and became an area juggernaut, and deservedly so.
Yeah, exactly.
they put in a lot of fucking work into
it. I'm pretty sure on one of our reviews way back when, I said to keep an eye on this haunt.
Yeah, on Rise, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, we were right.
I'm doing the same thing here.
Yeah.
Keep your eye on Decomposed.
I mean,
it's going to go places.
Is it the biggest, the baddest, the greatest haunt in Southeast Louisiana? No. But the platform is there. He is open. He has good knowledge of tactics, and he has actors with great instincts.
Yeah.
This can go places.
And he is going through stealth and looking at what his actors are doing.
Oh, my God. That was so... He told us that, and like, why don't others do that?
Yeah. Because, I mean, we do that.
Yeah.
Well, you don't do the stealth, but I'm in there with them and watching them.
Yeah.
The entire time.
You're embedded.
Exactly.
So we don't have to as much.
We don't have to do the stealth walkthrough of a giant haunt.
Yeah, but he does that semi-regularly.
Yeah.
And apparently heard one actor say boo.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised that actor's alive.
I don't know. There were some very realistic props in there.
That's true. He did not really discuss the aftermath much, did he?
No.
He was very opaque on that part.
The actor was corrected in some way or another.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah, he didn't go into a lot of details about the aftermath. So, you know, but apparently, you know, he's doing that, which is a good thing to do. And this way you can see what the actors are doing. You can critique and adjust. And, it's working. And, yeah, he's got a very young crew, but they definitely have good instincts. They definitely... Yeah. And you combine that with the design that he brings to it, because he really does nail this down very, very well. You're going to get some good startles here. It's a surprisingly effective haunt. And, like I said, the platform is there. Next year is going to be better. The year after that's going to be better.
Yeah.
The trajectory is only up.
Yes.
And so this is a solid start. And if I were in the area, definitely. I mean, because that's one of the things, like being in HOMA, you've got access to those population centers in and around HOMA, like Raceland, maybe Morgan City and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you got a fair amount of you've got a fair amount of people out there that you're close to. Definitely check it out. The only minor quibble I have is, okay, the $25 price tag is a little much for a first-year haunt. It's a big ask to take a risk on a new haunt, especially one that is short. But it's made a little bit worse, or a lot of it worse, by the issues they're having taking fucking money because of haunt pay.
Yeah.
Because if you show up, that is functionally cash only now.
Mm-hmm.
You can buy your tickets online, but apparently the scanners weren't working when we went through.
Right.
So they literally marked our tickets off by jotting my name down in a notebook.
Exactly.
It's like they've had so much trouble with haunt pay. It's mm-hmm. frustrating to see this brand new haunt getting kneecapped like this, because this is such a critical element.
Yeah.
Being able to receive payment for tickets is kind of important to haunt as a business.
It kind of is. It's kind of important to any business.
Yeah. So, yeah. Honestly, though, you know, I really don't, there's not too much to say about this year's Decomposed.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it is, like I said, it's short, it's the first year, a lot of it had to be done in 4 fucking weeks.
Yeah.
Because of those floods in August.
Right.
So, yeah, there's not a lot to say. But he confirmed he has the space.
Yeah.
He'll be working on it all year. I'm really fucking curious about 2023.
Yeah, and I'm just going to say about the pricing that I'm going to give it to him, because it's hard to raise your prices.
It is.
So if you're planning on having much bigger and much better next year,
yeah, that's a good point.
It's good to start it out closer to where you want to be.
And one thing you can do if you're in that position is find ways to offer discounts.
Mm-hmm.
Do coupon codes, do BOGO offers. You can offer deals, basically.
Yeah.
And to bring that price down. Like New Orleans Nightmare has that pre-sale.
Yeah.
The tickets are insanely cheap.
Yeah, but they also are trying to get a lot of people.
Yeah.
You know.
I don't know if this is really that mass type of haunt. But yeah. And so, on the way to Decomposed.
Yes.
Ellie was driving. She went uh-huh. with us for a lovely jaunt.
Yes.
Actually, first after Decomposed. No, never mind. Let's tell the story first. Okay. On the way to Decomposed, Crystal's in the back seat.
Uh-huh.
Looks out the window and goes, "Is that a haunted house?"
Uh-huh.
And I look, because now we're driving at 55 miles a fucking hour now.
Yeah.
So we're way down the road. I look, all I see is a bunch of people sitting around a TV in an RV.
Uh-huh.
I'm like, no, that's just a bunch of people sitting around a TV. That's nothing. And apparently I didn't see the stuff that was further back behind us at this
just
point.
Just before the RV.
Yeah. That would have indicated quite clearly it was a haunted house.
Yeah. I'm like, there are orange lights. It looks like a haunted house.
And it turns out it was.
Yeah.
But anyway, so...
Yeah, John confirmed it for us.
Yeah, John confirmed it for us. But we did have to make a quick pit stop for dinner.
Yeah.
And we ended up at a place called Melvin's.
Yeah.
And man, that was a wild experience.
It was a time warp.
Straight back to the 50s or 60s fine dining.
Yeah.
It was good food. Everything we ate was excellent,
yeah.
But it was...
Very good. But it was definitely something that was not expected, because it was the only restaurant that was open late in the area.
Yeah, that's a city that sidewalks roll up at 7.
Yeah, because we got there at about 9.
Yeah.
They were the only ones open until 10. So.
Yeah. Good food. But yeah, just the experience of that was creepy, just because the way it was
yeah.
and how late it was. It was a soup. We thought we were going into like an Addams Family house. It was as genuinely scary as any haunted house.
So many odd collections of just things.
Yeah, and the lighting choices make everything look stupid intimidating. They like lit the trees from underneath.
Yeah.
Which is an ancient thing trail haunts do all the time.
Yeah.
Because it makes the trees look scarier and more intimidating. They did that
mm-hmm.
for customers, for a restaurant.
Yeah.
It's like, what are you thinking?
Yeah, you drive through these lighted plants, because it's plants and trees that are lit from the bottom.
Yeah. It's,
into a very dark parking lot with nobody around.
Yeah, and all you see is, like, it looked like a house, even though
yeah.
it obviously wasn't. And you see a little open sign.
Yeah.
Lit in the window.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I mean, it had Bates Motel vibes
yeah.
going.
Anyways, so we got dinner, and then we made sure to try to hit the haunted house that we passed on the way.
Yeah.
Now, it's a haunted house we had not heard of before.
Mm-mm.
It's called Haunting on Da Bayou, D-A Bayou.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently, we spent a little time talking to the owner.
Uh-huh.
They have been a home haunt for a long time.
Right, in
over
a different location.
Yeah, in a different location.
Because this was in a small metal building, just on the road.
Yeah, right along US 90, which is not a minor road. It's a state highway. It's
yeah,
a big state highway.
Yeah, and it's like cars are flying by there.
Yeah.
Know?
But anyways, this haunt was so much fun. It was short. It was only about 4 minutes long.
Uh-huh.
But... yeah, you could tell this was a home haunter that found a way to open it up as a ticketed attraction.
Yeah.
And they were having fun with it.
Yeah, and we talked to them and before and after, and it's exactly what it was. I mean, you've got, you know, it was the cheesy little home haunt. You know, they had some scares in there. But it was also like a walk down memory lane for me.
Yeah.
As they kept everything.
Yeah.
So those old scene setter pictures.
Yeah.
Those were there.
Mm-hmm.
Like we had a tub of them at some point.
Yeah.
I don't know where
they
that
had
is.
The flickering Edison lights from Spirit.
Yeah.
I remember that because I loved those lights. That was mm-hmm. one of the few things that Spirit had that was really genuinely quite fun.
Mm-hmm.
And if you turn off the sound, especially, the effect was really, really good.
Yeah.
Because it had that electric cracking sound that sounded kind of artificial. But if you turn the sound off of it and just let the lights blink,
uh-huh.
it's a very, very interesting effect.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they also had a mix of some high-end stuff, too. They had some mm-hmm. high-end... props outside and inside. They also had some LCD panels.
Yeah.
And things like that. It was a wild hodgepodge of both, you know, very home haunt, pro haunt, and everything in between.
Yeah. And the actors were so enthusiastic.
Yeah, you can tell this is a friends and family operation because mm-hmm. timing may not have always been their forte.
Yeah.
But making it entertaining was.
Yeah. And I will say, this is the first time I have been stalked through a haunt mm-hmm. for that long. And it does get unsettling after a while.
Especially when it's that weird clown dude.
Yeah. Not saying anything.
Yeah, not saying anything.
Never said a word.
Not even really doing anything. Not trying to...
Yeah. Yeah, now I understand why customers, whenever I used to do that, would be like, "We've already seen you, go away."
Well, I tell you that all the time, too.
Yeah, I'm sure he... Oh, thanks. I'm sure he... or the person in the clown mask gets that, too.
Oh, yeah. I am 100% sure of that. And honestly, that was a really good clown mask.
Yeah.
Because it was genuinely very disturbing.
Yeah, and there was a little bit of fog in it. There was also a scene where a nurse was killing a patient.
Yeah.
That I had a lot of fun with.
Yeah.
They were very energetic.
Yeah, I mean, that's just it. This was clearly a friends and family operation. Everyone was, they took our money.
Yeah.
But I could tell that was kind of secondary, and it was kind of confirmed by the mm-hmm. by the proprietor who walked us through with us.
There's a picture of Jonathan outside
in a coffin.
In a coffin.
Never met a coffin I won't jump in.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was a coffin or a casket.
It was a casket, actually.
Okay. That's why I let you pick the word.
Well, you know, at this point in the colloquial, I think they're functionally synonyms.
Yeah.
Even though there is a technical difference.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure colloquially they're just synonyms.
Yeah.
Because no one uses coffins for funerals anymore. Almost all funerals now have caskets.
Yeah.
And for those that don't know, caskets are square. Coffins have the tapered sides.
Ah, so what we have are coffins.
Yeah, our
coffin is a coffin.
We have coffins.
Yeah.
Our coffin closet and our coffin coffee table are actual coffins.
Yeah.
Because they have the tapered sides.
Right.
But caskets are just rectangles.
Yeah, with the little rounded lid.
Yeah.
Okay, I get it.
Yeah. For those playing along at home, it was definitely a casket, but it was nice and comfy. I liked it in there. I wanted them to shove me in and let me take a nap.
Yeah.
Would have been the best sleep I got all fucking on season, I'll tell you that
probably.
Much.
Probably. Sleep fit for the dead.
Exactly. But
that'd be a good hotel idea.
No, honestly, though, if you're in that region, I would encourage you to check that one out, too. It is a lot of fun. And like I said, everyone there is enthusiastic. We couldn't hang around much. I mean, it was already late in the evening. We were there like 10:30.
Yeah.
So it was already late.
It was 11:30 when we... Or 11. We rolled up at 11. Yeah, they had thought they were done for the night. They were all sitting outside.
Which I understand. We're the assholes showing up trying to go to their haunt at damn near 11.
Yeah, we didn't think they'd be open, but they were.
My plan when we pulled up was to honestly just get the information and come back.
Yeah.
Because it was close enough that we could hit it another night.
Yeah.
But, because that was like sitting between here and home was about a third of the way.
About 30 minutes.
Yeah, it's about 30 to 40 minutes from our house.
Yeah.
But, man, they were very, very kind to us. They let us go through. They seemed a little surprised that we got through as quickly as we did.
Yeah.
I wonder if some of the actors are supposed to be holding us up.
Yeah.
And it's just as regular haunt goers. That's not how we operate.
Right. Yeah. And there is one thing that I will caution against.
Okay.
If you have any kind of sensitivity to fog, the entire building does have fog in it.
Yeah. So any asthma issues or anything like that?
Yeah.
Probably not a good trip for
you. Yeah, I have a slight sensitivity, so I wound up with a sore throat the next day.
Yeah, it wasn't, like, filled with fog or anything, to be clear. Like, I've seen haunts that do that, like the whiteout mazes and things like that. It wasn't like that. But it was, you could definitely smell it in the air.
Yeah.
More than you could see it.
Mm. Yeah.
But yeah, that was a lot of fun, and that concluded our Friday trip.
Yes, and it was a surprise, second...
Yeah, and that's continuing the tradition of an extra haunted house.
Exactly.
Oui, bueno. But no, and after that, we just went back to work on our haunt.
Actually, we took the night off because we got back after midnight.
Yeah, but that night we took off. Saturday, all day Sunday
was
dedicated to working on our haunt. We already covered that.
Yeah.
But Sunday night was a special night for me. And as longtime listeners will know, we're huge fans of the film Repo, the Genetic Opera.
Yes.
Tremendous fans of it.
It's actually only the second movie ever to get nods in the props inside the haunt.
Yeah.
And the first was our first year, so I'm not counting that one.
Yeah, that wasn't even a movie. That was just a book. We're doing public domain, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, this year we're doing On the Sly references to Repo because we're doing an organ repossession theme or a stealing organ theme. And, of course, we're going to do nods to Repo.
Yeah, there are subtle nods.
The story,
if you know the movie, you'll get it. If you don't, it'll just look creepy.
It'll just go bye-bye. It'll be fine. Yeah, because we're telling the story of the classic urban legend organ theft.
Yeah.
And we're setting it so that this was recent transplant recipients receiving it.
Uh-huh.
So, because that way the doctor knew the blood type, knew the compatibility and all that. And had all the information and can easily just take the organ out.
Mm-hmm.
But
anyway, last night.
Last night, we got to see Repo the Genetic Opera with Shadowcast.
Yes.
Never have we had the ability to do that. We've been fans of this for damn near a decade now.
Yeah. And they've never shown it that way.
No. We've been to a million bajillion Rocky Horror with Shadowcast screens.
Yes, and we always ask them, do you know anybody who does Repo? And they say, no, what's Repo?
And okay, I get it. Repo is challenging to do a Shadowcast because, as they pointed out, it's got a lot of fucking characters in it.
It does.
Compared to Rocky in particular, it's got a lot of fucking people in it. I agree with that.
Yeah.
It's a little more difficult.
Which is really funny because if you know enough about the movie, they were short on people in the actual movie.
Yeah.
Like, they were using extras and grips and stuff for the extras in the background.
Like, one piece of Repo trivia that a lot of people don't know is when they get to the Genetic Opera, the big scene at the end, the band on stage is wearing masks. Because it's the same people on stage that are in the audience. Because they only had a license to get X number of extras. So they just, okay, everyone put on these band suits and wear these gold masks and pretend to pantomime the instruments.
Yeah.
And then go sit in your theater scene and pretend to watch the show you just put on.
Yeah.
And like you said, for one scene, 17, the song, where that's the, where Shiloh's having the daydream, I guess.
Yeah.
And there's like a mob outside her door. Yeah, that's just all the grips and all the lighting people walking around to the backside, pretending to be
fans.
Yeah. So yeah, they it's always hilarious when they complain, when people understandably do complain. There's a lot of characters.
Oh, yeah.
They were way short on people filming that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we got to see it live. A burlesque troupe and the Shadowcast troupe locally did it. Made my fucking night. I had an incredible time.
Yeah.
Stayed up way too goddamn late.
Yes.
Had a little bit too much to drink.
A little bit.
But I had a great time, and it was all happiness.
Yeah.
It's all wonderment and happiness.
Yes, I hope that they're able to do it again.
Oh, God.
In not October.
Yeah, not October. Please, 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 do it in December.
Yeah.
Do it around Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving's actually kind of perfect.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're not doing shit. Well, we can't.
I know.
We can't go anywhere.
No.
Because now Ellie has two reasons she can't leave on Black Friday.
Yeah.
Her day job and her new yarn store.
Yes.
So anyways, that was so much fun. And it was so, we're in my office recording this. On my wall, I legitimately have two separate Repo the Genetic Opera posters.
Yeah.
One with actual clips of film from the movie, mm-hmm. from one of the celluloid copies of the movie.
That we made it to light up. Oh,
yeah, and I got to fix the light in that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I want more repo stuff. I'm going to get more repo stuff.
Yeah.
But, yeah, anyways, it was great. A dream come true. We actually, during the pandemic, mm-hmm. when movie theaters were selling out and letting you just pay $50 to show whatever you want.
Yeah.
We actually paid $50 to Broad Street Theater here in New Orleans to let us have a private screening of Repo on the big screen.
I think it was more like $150. But yes, we got to take our DVD copy of it.
A Blu-ray.
They
asked for a Blu-ray.
Yeah, Blu-ray. Put it in and watch it by ourselves on giant movie screen. That was really cool.
That was so cool. So that's how big of fans we are of this. But anyways, on that note, everyone, thank you very much for joining us for this past hour. It's been great having you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a fan of Repo, please let us know. We need to meet more Repo fans.
Yeah.
We're a surprisingly sparse and thinly sprinkled out group.
Mm-hmm.
You can let us know that at HauntWeekly.com, HauntWeekly on Twitter, HauntWeekly on Facebook, YouTube.com/HauntWeekly. Also, take the time, answer the question of the week there.
Mm-hmm.
But until next time. I'm Jonathan.
I'm Crystal.
And we will see you all next week. We're a minor announcement here. We are not doing a news episode. It is supposed to be a news episode in order, but we will be too busy to compile news. So we'll have something else.
Yeah.
It'll be something, but it will not be news. We'll catch up on the news in another month.
Mm-hmm.
See you all then.